Chores are not paired up. I hope you're getting me. Generally, we call an inner-orbital complex a low-spin complex because that's at the expense of lowering the spin magnetic moment. That's because a strong field again would be pairing up electrons. Now, I'm calling it inner-orbital complex because the inner d-orbitals are used. I'm calling it IOC because the inner d-orbitals are used. But you know, I'll avoid calling it a low-spin complex because I find no electrons are paired up. Yes or no? Yet again, the reason I'm promoting or I'm projecting ammonia as a strong field ligand here is because it's finding the inner orbital. I'm projecting ammonia as a strong field ligand here is it's finding the inner orbitals. Even for copper, you know, I wanted you to remember ammonia as a strong field ligand because it was protruding into the inner orbital. Believe me, with coordination number 4, an inner a strong field ligand is more likely to get dsp2, and with coordination number 6, a strong field ligand is more likely to take up d2sp3 kind of hybridization. Yes or no? Now in copper 3d9 and in chromium 3d3, you find ammonia taking up the inner orbital complex form. I mean, ammonia acting as a strong field ligand because it's able to have a dsp2 there and d2sp3 hybridization here. Yes or no? Although, you know, it's not pairing up the electrons. I hope you're following me. So I'm calling ammonia a strong field ligand not because it's pairing up electrons in copper and chromium, but because it's able to protrude into the inner orbital. But because it's able to, you know, gain access to 3D orbital, affecting a dsp2 or a d2sp3 hybridization here. Yes or no? In cobalt, it was actually responsible for pairing up electrons. In cobalt, ammonia was actually responsible for pairing up electrons, and there it was getting inner orbital complex by pairing up electrons by decreasing the count of unpaired electron by lowering the spin magnetic moment. And I want all of you to be, you know, completely following what I want to convey. Although I'm calling it inner orbital complex, I'll avoid calling it low spin complex because I don't find the magnetic moment lowered, because I don't find ammonia pairing up electrons. We'll take up all these subtle issues, believe me. We'll talk at length about all of them. And then, you know, at some point of time, we'll start debating whether a strong field ligand is there to pair up electrons or it's there to take up only the inner orbitals. What's the actual nature of a strong field ligand? How would you want to define a strong field ligand? Is it a ligand which is pairing up the electrons, or it's a ligand which is only happy gaining inner orbitals? So far, for cobalt, I saw ammonia pairing up the electrons and then gaining the inner d orbitals. But in copper, it was a different situation altogether. In copper, you know, it was migrating an electron from 3d to 4p, if you remember. And out here, it doesn't need to pair up electrons. Still, it manages to get d2sp3 kind of arrangement, inner orbital complex. But still, I'll avoid calling it an inner orbital complex. Octahedral, paramagnetic, 3 unpaired electron will make mu is equal to root 15. Yes or no? Yes or no? Platinum Cl4-2. Yet again, a particularly different complex. Platinum Cl4-2. Now, looking at the 3D, 4D and 5D patterns, you realize nickel, palladium and platinum will have 3D8, 4D8 and 5D8 configuration. Nickel, palladium and platinum, you know, will fall in the same group. And the way, you know, we knew Ni plus 2 is 3D8, let's acknowledge that platinum plus 2 should be 5D8. Yes or no? And this was the first complex which I did for you. Actually, it also happens to be the first printed complex in problem 3, which was NiCl4-2-. Now, in NiCl4-2-3D8, we initially wrote for the D8 configuration, which I am going to do for 5D this time. So this is how it's supposed to look like. This is a D8 configuration. This is a D8 configuration. Yes or no? 5D8 configuration. and I'll expect chlorine to be a weak field ligand. Throughout I've been finding chlorine a weak field ligand. I'll expect it to take up S and P orbitals, effect sp3 hybridization and form a tetrahedral geometry which is paramagnetic. Yes or no? Now contrary to all these expectations, you'll find PtCl4 2- to be diamagnetic, no unpaired electron and square planar. Now how do you go about explaining it? The only way you could explain diamagnetism and square planarity in platinum chloride complexes, this time if you're forced to take chlorine as a strong field ligand. So let's take chlorine as a strong field ligand here. That makes this discussion again particularly significant. I want all of you to take a note of this complex again. So far, chlorine has been pretty smoothly acting as a weak field ligand. But for platinum, and once we are done explaining it for platinum, I'll tell you the same will happen with palladium also. For nickel, chlorine will be a weak field ligand. But both for palladium and platinum, you'll find chlorine rearranging a pairing of the electrons here against Hund's rule, in the process acting as a strong field ligand, in the process vacating a d orbital, and instead of sp3 it's going to be dsp2. Now dsp2 would mean no electrons are unpaired, magnetic moment is zero, the complex is diamagnetic and the complex is expected to be square planar. Alright, now as I said, you will want to take a strong note of it for complexes of platinum palladium. Chlorine is acting as a strong field ligand. Okay? Now the time we have spent drawing for all these structures and accounting for the magnetic behavior and the structure of these complexes, we are supposed to at least believe in valence bond theory and hybridization. Certainly so many times we have to frame the logic from experimental observations depending upon the magnetic behavior and the structure of the complexes. But certainly we have a way of now explaining all the magnetic behavior and the various structures taken up by different complexes. Parallelly, while doing all of it, on more than a couple of occasions, we had to actually go by certain assumptions. We had to come through certain exceptions, and believe me, personally, I prefer calling them variations than exceptions. Maybe, before we progress, we'll want to quickly look at some of the situations which forced us to move from the expected structure of the complexes. Now one was ammonia acting as a strong field ligand with copper, cobalt and chromium complexes. Now we had to kind of live with it, we had to just go by this to explain the nature of the complexes. Wherein in cobalt you found it pairing up the electrons, in chromium and copper though it was not pairing up the electrons, it was taking up dsp2 or d2sp3 hybridization. So far, I guess I've been able to convey that FeH2O plus 6, well, it's going to be the same as COH2O6 plus 3. So it doesn't matter whether it's iron complex or cobalt complex. I hope you follow me. Because for both of them we found the same structure and the same magnetic moment. And down the line, just need to look at it, realize both are 3d6, water being a weak field ligand, there will be 4 unpaired electron, mu root 24, and that's how you're going to quickly interpret the structure and the magnetic moment of the complex. I hope I'm not hard to understand here. So we down the line are not going to associate too much with the nature of the central metal, rather we'll want to limit our discussion to the electronic configuration only. instead of Arana complex or Kovata complex, will want to think of a 3D6 rearrangement. I'm sorry, a 3D6 configuration. I repeat, henceforth, instead of talking about the central metal or, you know, being very, very critical about it acting as a strong field ligand or a weak field ligand for one particular complex, would rather want to think of it acting as a strong field ligand or a weak field ligand for a given configuration. In the sense, Fe plus 2 and Cu plus 3 both being 3D6, and we are arriving at the same results. So more than the exact nature of the complex, we'll want to think and talk of the configuration. Yes or no? Now we found that in 3D8 there was no pairing. Although, you know, it would have been more convenient if I had spoken in terms of Ni plus 2, but sooner than later I want people to break free from the nature of the element and rather think of the configuration only. We found 3D8, there was no pairing if it was an octahedral complex. I hope you have been following me. And the logic, the explanation which I come up with is, even if they are paired up, it will not get 2 empty d orbital. It will not get 2 empty d orbital. Yes or no? But again, it puts us in some kind of quandary. We are not decided. We actually get a little confused that whether the job of a strong field ligand is to pair up electrons, whether the job of a strong field ligand is to actually pair up electrons, or its job is to find out whether after pairing I'll have 2 empty d orbitals available or not. Now these might be two contradictory theories, you know, these might be two contradictory behavior. I mean, as a strong field ligand, it will just want to pair up electrons and doesn't matter whether d2sp3 is getting realized or not. I mean, if it's a strong field ligand capable of pairing up electrons disobeying Hund's rule, it will want to do it even if it's not making way for d2sp3. Yes or no? So that puts us in some kind of confusion, in some kind of introspection, that when we call it a strong field ligand, is it supposed to only pair up electrons, or the pairing will depend upon whether d2sp3 or that particular hybridization is possible or not? Because, you know, the strong field ligand would have ideally paired up electrons and still gone ahead with sp3d2. Yes or no? So I find this a little ambiguous. All right, a d2sp3 was not available, but a strong field ligand would have paired up electrons anyways, because primarily our approach to strong field ligand has been the one which has been breaking or disobeying Hund's rule. Yes or no? So I find this a little ambiguous. For 3D8 octahedral complexes, more often than not it's going to come as an Ni plus 2 complex, but, you know, we'll want to talk more of the configuration than of the individual element. 3D3 chromium ka complex jo tha, chromium ammonia complex, you found ammonia is not pairing it up. If you remember CrNH3+3, you found ammonia is not pairing up the electrons, and yet again the explanation I come up with is it doesn't need to pair up electrons because it's anyways getting 2 empty d orbitals. Now yet again it puts us into the same thought, that whether the strong field ligand is going to check only for the availability of d2 orbitals, or it's going to force pairing of electrons. You know, in 3D8 it's not pairing up electrons because anyways d orbitals were not available. In 3D3, yet again it's not pairing up electrons, and this time, I mean, if I come up with a logic, I hope you all are understanding me. Here it was not pairing up electrons, and I told you pairing would not have helped, and here it's not pairing up electrons, and my explanation is it doesn't need to pair up, it's getting d2 anyways. But again, the point is, a strong field ligand, is it supposed to only check for the availability of d2 orbitals, or it's going to, you know, force pairing up of electrons? And depending upon, you know, whether or not we're able to get rid of this confusion, we'll not be able to define a strong field ligand ideally. Yes or no? Now, by the by the way that the term sounds, a strong field ligand is going to generate a stronger field which will pair up electrons. No matter even if pairing is going to help or not, no matter if pairing is required or not. I mean, it would have paired up 3D3 even, although 2D orbitals were found to be vacant. So I repeat, you know, we start questioning again that strong field ligand, is it there to check the availability of D orbitals and then only pair up, or by default it should pair up the electrons and then it's just about whether D2 is made available or not. 3D mein pair up nahi kar raha hai because it would not have helped. 3D3 mein pair up nahi kar raha hai because 2D orbitals are already available. But you know, we're not happy with both the situations where I'm finding strong field ligand not pairing up the electrons. And last but not the least, you know, this was again a little hard to believe. Chloride suddenly acting as a strong field ligand. And then you come across more complexes, you find more variations of this kind. So somewhere, you know, you need to draw a line. Somewhere you need to be more scientific and more logical about it. You just can't keep on, you know, accepting by the structure of the complex. You know, just can't go on accepting exceptions and variations. Somewhere you'll have to come up with more logical and scientific explanation of why ammonia is a strong field ligand somewhere and weak field ligand elsewhere. Why chloride is generally a weak field ligand, but with platinum palladium it's acting as a strong field ligand. All right, assuming it to be a strong field ligand, certainly we are able to explain the diamagnetism and square planar complex. But somewhere at the back of our mind, you know, we'll want this to be understood more logically, more scientifically. Believe me, with more number of complexes we come across, and you know, more aberrations encountered, certainly in terms of a strong field ligand acting as a weak field ligand somewhere or vice versa, yet again the need for a more scientific explanation, the need for a more advanced theory will be felt. Now before we move into that, before we try to explain all of it with a new approach, with a new theory, I would have wanted you people to have understood the basic limitations of, or you know, the basic loopholes of what we have done so far. Please let me know if there is anything which I want to you want me to repeat for you, and then only, you know, we'll want to talk of a theory so that we are more comfortably going to explain and more logically going to explain so many variations which we have come across. Got me? So just have a go through. We'll kind of resume in 10 minutes and we'll take up what's called crystal